Hi everybody. Thank you for joining us this evening. We are going to be discussing about the rise of facial recognition, especially what it's going to be looking like in this post-COVID world. But while we talk about the post-COVID scenarios, we want to give you a sense of what has been happening in India, why and how facial recognition has come into use in policing or in general government. This event is being hosted by Internet Foundation. I know of the work of the Internet Freedom Foundation. It's a volunteer-run organization which works for your digital rights, and it heavily relies on independent donations. Kindly do check their website, internetfreedom.in, and if you like their work, kindly support them by donating. On that note, we have with us three amazing people who have been doing interesting work in the facial recognition. We have Anushka Jain, who is a fellow with Internet Freedom Foundation, a policy researcher documenting disruptive technologies in artificial intelligence, facial recognition, and machine learning. Her work has been involving using mechanisms like RTE document these ongoing developments in India. Anushka will start the talk, and then we'll move on to Vidushi Martha. Vidushi is a with works Article 19's digital team. Her primary work has been to document emerging technologies both from a policy and a society perspective. And then we have Smriti. Smriti is now currently with CyberBricks project, but she was previously with the NIPFP. I guess Smriti can tell you more about her work, but all of these people have been documenting facial recognition in the country for the past few years, and I'll let Anushka start the session explaining you what Internet Freedom Foundation has been doing in this space.
Hi everyone, my name is Anushka Jain and I work as the Transparency and RTI Fellow at Internet Freedom Foundation. This is my first webinar, so I am nervous, but I'm mostly excited about doing this webinar with my co-panelists, Vidushi and Smriti, both of whose work I have been following with regard to my research on facial recognition technology. So, to start off, let's talk about what facial recognition technology is and why it is used. So briefly, facial recognition technology systems use machine learning, and what they do is they extract information from a video or an image that a camera or a CCTV has captured. In this process, firstly, they detect a face from the image, and then they extract features from the face that they have detected, which they then use to recognize the individual. So this recognition can be in the form of identification or in the form of verification. Now I want to tell you that I'm going to go into detail of why how facial recognition technology works, because my co-panelists are going to talk about it more. Facial recognition technology is mainly used for two purposes. We can categorize these two purposes into security or surveillance, authentication of identity. So why are we talking about facial recognition technology? So currently there have been a lot of, if you have been following the news, there have been a lot of projects of facial recognition technology which have started to get launched. Now the question that comes is, why do we have to worry about facial recognition technology? So the question that many people have asked me is, if I have not done anything wrong, then why should I be worried? So the answer to this is that this technology is being implemented without having a proper legal framework or an SOP in place to regulate them. So what will happen if they are implemented with a lack of legal framework? So there can be two outcomes. There can be the implementation of an inaccurate FRT system. Now, what this means is that the FRT system will not be able to either identify correctly or will misidentify. So what this means is there can be a false positive. A false positive occurs when I am identified as somebody I am not. So if I am identified as a criminal by the police, this could lead to discrimination. The second thing that could occur is there could be a false negative. What is in this situation, what will happen I will not be identified as someone that as myself. So this would lead to, for example, if facial recognition is being used for Aadhaar, so I will not be identified as myself, and thus it would lead me to be excluded from the benefits that the Aadhaar system provides me. The second system, the obvious answer to this is, let's then implement an accurate facial recognition system that would solve all the problems. The problem with the implementation of an accurate facial recognition system would be that it could facilitate function creep. Now, what I mean by function creep is the police is saying, for example, the police is saying that they are using facial recognition to find missing children. But the police is also using facial recognition system to identify individuals which they think will perform some criminal act. So now, obviously, this is a function creep wherein the technology which they said they are going to use to identify missing children only is now being used for some other function. This would lead to a back-end integration of the data which is collected and could result in complete profiles of individuals being created, which could then lead to state-sponsored mass surveillance. So what Internet Freedom Foundation has done is we have launched a project called Project Panoptic. In this, I will tell you how this project came to be. So over the last few months, we noticed that there were a lot of news stories that were coming out with regard to the use of facial recognition all over the country. So there was the use of facial recognition in Delhi during the protest. There was the use of facial recognition in Telangana. There's the use of facial recognition in Mumbai for airports. So we thought that we should start tracking all these projects just to be aware of what is happening. So through this tracking, we understood that there is an extreme increase in the number of projects of facial recognition that are being introduced both at the central as well as the state level. So what we did was we developed an active tracker which started mapping all the facial recognition technology projects across the country. And our main aim was to create a database which would contain all possible information about these projects. The information that we collected was collected through different sources, such as official government press releases and notification, newspaper articles that we came across, as well as other information which we could verify for its authenticity. By other sources, I mean, for example, the facial recognition technology vendor has themselves on their website said that we have sold this technology to this government authority. So this is also a verified source from which we got information. However, the problem was that even though we had a lot of information that we got, there was still information. This was still information that the government itself or the technology vendor itself had decided to disclose. So in such a situation, obviously they will disclose what they want to disclose, and also they were disclosing enough for a layman. They were not disclosing enough for legal analysis to take place. So what we thought was we should do something that could allow us to have a complete database of how these projects are implemented. So we started filing right to information requests with the relevant government authorities so that we could extract all the information that we thought was crucial to gain a 360 degree view of the project. We did this because FRT systems by their very nature are intrusive into the right to privacy, and the deployment is being done in secrecy. So we don't actually know that these systems are being deployed, and they are being deployed even though they are very, very intrusive with the right of privacy. So we thought also the right to information requests are important because they facilitate transparency with regard to government actions and also other relevant stakeholders. And this transparency will then directly correlates to accountability that you can ask from these government authorities. So this is a sample RTI request that we have filed with the Delhi police for the facial recognition system that they have deployed. So I will talk about what exactly do we ask in such a RTI request that we file to get information about facial recognition. Firstly, we ask them what legislative backing or legal authority they had based on which they are deploying these systems. This is because according to the Puttiswamy judgment on the right to privacy, any action that the government takes that is intruding into our right to privacy has to be justified by a legislative backing. So this is the first question that we ask. We also ask them if they consulted the law department of the government or any other legal consultation they did prior to deploying such projects. The second question we ask them is the cost-benefit analysis or the privacy impact assessment that they are doing before conducting, before deploying such systems. The third question that we ask them is whether before the deployment they had in place any standard operating procedure which would govern the use of these FRT systems. We also ask them what is the purpose for which they are going to use this FRT system. And as I said earlier, these purposes can usually be categorized into either security or surveillance or authentication of identity. We also ask them the total expenditure that they have incurred for the procurement and deployment of these FRT systems. We also ask them to provide us with a copy of all the tender documents that the government authority has issued, which also includes the request for proposals, request for quotations, and the scope of work. This allows us to get a holistic view of what the project is and what is the scope of the project. Next, we ask them who will be using the FRT system that they are deploying. By this, what we want to assess is what is the level of authority that you need to do this, or is anybody who is related to, for example, say a police station can use this. So if you're not on that higher rank, can you still use the FRT system? We ask them for what duration will they store the data that they have collected. Now, this is an important question because it is important according to the GDPR, it is important that data, especially personal data which is collected, is stored only for the period of time that is relevant to the purpose for which it is being collected. So in this situation, if the data is being collected for say security purposes, a normal amount of time that you would think that they would store it is for say 30 days or for the period of investigation. So we need to understand, are they doing this for the for this duration, or are they keeping it with them and creating a profile at the back end? The next question we ask them is the storage location of the database created and the list of people and or organizations who will have access to the database. Again, the question comes is what will be the level of authority which is necessary for a person to have access to this information. Now, this is a very basic question because if they are creating such a database which will have personal data about every individual, we need to ensure that it is not accessible to every person. We need to ensure that there is some level of authority that is necessary you access this information, thus ensuring accountability. We also ask them the details about the software and the hardware that they're using for the FRT system. So where are we with regard to our tracker? Our tracker is currently mapping around 30 FRT systems all over the country. The list is dynamic in nature because we keep getting news that another system has been deployed. So we keep updating this tracker. So this tracker includes three central projects, which are the National Automated Facial Recognition System under the Ministry of Home Affairs, the DigiYatra project under the Ministry of Civil Aviation, and the Internet Protocol-Based Video Surveillance System under the Ministry of Railways. Other than these central projects, there are also around 27 projects at the state level. It is interesting to note here that at the state level, the projects are usually FRT systems that police departments have deployed. So it would be surprising to most people that almost all police departments across the country have their own facial recognition system in place, or they have a tender out to procure such a system. The main reason for this use by police departments is for security or surveillance purposes. The Ministry of Railways as well is using this system for security and surveillance. However, the Ministry of Civil Aviation is using it for authentication of identity. What they're doing with the DigiYatra project is they're going to make checking into your flight totally paperless, so that just through your face you can check into your flight. Now, interestingly, the National Automated Facial Recognition System is going to do both. It is going to do security and surveillance as well as authentication of identity. So we have filed RTI requests with almost all of the authorities in our tracker, excluding the ones that we found out about after the lockdown was in place, because with some government authorities, you have to send physical RTIs, whereas the central and Delhi government and the Maharashtra government allow you to file RTIs online. So the main aim of Project Panoptic is to create a public resource which will help raise awareness and transparency around these FRT systems. So this resource that we're talking about would mainly be an interactive map which will help the user who is using it to gain access to all the information that we have collected at the back end, so that if they are personally interested in only one project, then they can directly go to that one project and get information about that project. This resource we are developing with the DataKind Bangalore, and it will be operational in the coming months. Our ultimate goal with regard to this project is to use this project to shape IFF's own advocacy initiatives, which will include policy interventions as well as strategic litigation. So these advocacy initiatives have already been started at IFF, and we are at the beginning stages of different policy interventions as well as a strategic litigation. We also hope that this resource will also help the advocacy initiatives of other organizations and individuals who are personally affected by one of the FRT systems. So if you are a user in, say, Jharkhand, who has been affected by the FRT system that the police is using there, you can go to this resource that we are creating, get the information, and then you can do what you want to do, which could include filing a case against the use of this system against the police. So that is also one of the functions that we hope to achieve through the project, through this project. So now I'm going to talk about three case studies in which I'm going to show, firstly, I'm going to talk about the project which has been launched, and then I'm going to talk about what IFF under Project Panoptic has done in that particular case. So the first case that I'm going to talk about is the National Automated Facial Recognition System. This project has been launched by the NCRB, and right now it's at the request for proposal stage. Funnily enough, this project was launched last year in July, and they are still at the first stage. The deadline to submit the bids has been extended 8 times now, and the next deadline is on July 17. So what they are trying to do with this project essentially is they want to create a facial recognition system which would be used to create a national database of photographs. What they want to with these photographs is to identify criminals, and for this they are going to integrate this national database of photographs with other already existing databases. These databases include the passport database, the CCTNS database, the ICJS database, the Khoya Paya portal of the Women and Child Development Ministry, the automated fingerprint identification system, as well as any other image database that is available with the police or any other entity. So now what IFF has done under Project Panoptic for this particular project is in December, we sent a legal notice to the NCRB challenging the implementation of AFRS. We said that the AFRS cannot be implemented mainly because they lack a legal framework or a legislative backing to implement this project, which will intrude into the right to privacy of every individual in India. We received a reply from the NCRB in which they justified their action, saying that AFRS is justified due to a cabinet note which exists from, I forget the year, but there is a cabinet note which they have used to justify the implementation of AFRS. Now, a cabinet note cannot be used as a legislative backing for implementation of such a project, and as a follow-up, we did send them a rejoinder stating that this justification is insufficient. Next, we also sent a representation to the NCRB and the MHA to halt the tender process that they have ongoing, and we called for a 3-year moratorium to be put on the facial recognition technology use in India. Now, I'm not going to go into the moratorium versus ban argument because I know that my co-panelists are going to handle that. The next case study that I want to talk about is the Delhi police's use of facial recognition. So you might have read in the news that the Delhi police has been using facial recognition for surveillance since December of last year. So they used facial recognition for surveillance during the protest that happened in December, and they have been using facial recognition since then. So what we did was we filed RTI requests with them to get the information on how these systems have been implemented, and we received the reply we received was substantial because it disclosed new information with regard to the legal authority for deployment that the Delhi police is using to justify their deployment, the purpose of use, as well as the total expenditure that the Delhi police has incurred. So this is a photograph of the reply that we received. Now, if you see, they have said that the justification that they have given for use of facial recognition is that in the case that the Delhi High Court has allowed them to use facial recognition in the case of Sadan Haldar. Now, I want you to know that in Sadan Haldar, the Delhi High Court had said that facial recognition technology can be used to identify and find missing children. But now, if you look at this answer, with the Delhi police themselves have provided, they said that FRS technology may be used in investigation in the interest of safety and security of the general public. So this is the kind of function creep that I was talking about earlier, wherein the Delhi police has widened the scope of their use by saying that the High Court justifies this use, but the use that High Court is justifies is much narrower than the use that Delhi police is actually doing. As you see here that this is the total amount of expenditure that they have incurred with regard to facial recognition technology. The last case study that I'm going to talk about is the Telangana Election Commission. So what happened with the Telangana State Election Commission was they released a circular in January of this year where they said that they would be running a pilot project in 10 polling stations. What will happen in these polling stations was they will use facial recognition technology to verify the identity of the voters, and this was done in a bid to counter voter impersonation. So what they said was this technology has been developed and supplied to them by the Telangana State Technology Services, and we were very worried about facial recognition being used for voter verification. So we filed multiple RTIs with them, and we filed the RTIs with the State Election Commission as well as the Telangana State Technology Services. We asked them about the specifics of the project, the legal basis, the details on expenditure, and the safeguards in place to protect people's constitutional rights. So in the replies that we received, we unearthed a lot of information with regard to the legal basis of the project as well as the expenditure that was incurred. We also asked and received information about the accuracy of the project itself. So the information that we unearthed, which was very important, was that the accuracy of the facial recognition system that they're using is only 78% overall. Now, in such a situation where they're using facial recognition to verify the identity of voters and the accuracy is only 78%, we need to understand that this would lead to somebody not being able to vote, which is a right guaranteed under the Constitution. So this creates a big problem. So this is the kind of information that you can unearth using RTI. This is a photograph of the RTI response that we received. And you can see here, I'm not sure if you can, but it said 78% of the overall on the overall accuracy of the project. I would like to end my presentation by saying that while RTIs are not as incremental in bringing about change when compared to litigation, but RTIs help us in making sure that the government authorities that are working for us are transparent and accountable to what they are doing. And I will now end my presentation. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Anushka. Thanks so much. I will now ask Vidushi to please come on and begin her part of the webinar. Vidushi, I've also given you presenter access, so you should be able to upload your presentation. It's already been uploaded. You can now show it to everyone here.
Hi, thank you, Shani. I'm actually just looking for my presentation. I can't see it in the portal.
You should go to upload presentations and then you will see it listed there.
Oh, got it. Just give me 1 second. Thank you for bearing with me. Great. So thank you so much. And thank you, Anushka, for giving us a really comprehensive overview of the work that IFF has been doing so far. With the time allotted to me, what I wanted to do was kind of talk about, zoom out a little bit and talk about issues that we've been facing and seeing as researchers for the last 2 years when it comes to facial recognition technologies in India. I'm going to draw from learnings from my work in other jurisdictions such as the European Union and the US, and also kind of talk about the different stakeholders at play. So before going any further, I do want to spend some time going a little deeper into what types of facial recognition we have, because I think one of the things that we risk doing is talking about facial recognition systems like they are one thing, when in fact they are very, very different when you look at the different types that we have. So the first type is called 1:1 matching. It's the process of verification. And basically the question here for the computer or the system is this person who she claims she is? So when you hold your phone in front of you to unlock it, it's an instance of verification because the phone already knows who you are. So it's essentially matching one face with one picture. And here is where we have, you know, questions about data protection, of course, you know, where is your photo being stored? How does the computer take each instance of your photographs and understand that, things like that? And also accuracy, right? It would be really inconvenient if your phone didn't accurately detect your face. It's also very sanitized in that the computer has a neat idea, or the system has a very neat idea and a very specific idea of what your face looks like. I do want to also stress on the fact that facial recognition makes a biometric map of your face. So it is fundamentally different to a photograph. A lot of people do think that facial recognition is just the next logical step to CCTV cameras. But in fact, it's much closer to a fingerprint, except it makes your face a fingerprint in many ways. So the second type, which is largely what Anushka was talking about, is 1:N matching. This is the process of identification, where the question is, who is this person? Right. So the system doesn't necessarily know who you are. If you've walked down a street in India and a CCTV camera has caught your footage under the national AFRS system, it's possible that your face is in a database somewhere that is being used to fuel this nationwide facial recognition system, but you may or may not exist within it. So what happens is there is mass surveillance without any sort of rationale. So it's an open-ended data collection exercise. When the Home Ministry introduced the AFRS in July 2019, one of the most striking things that they said was, this is not at all a privacy concern because it only concerns itself with criminals, quote-unquote criminals. But that, I think, is misunderstanding the technology at a really fundamental level. So fundamentally, every person who passes a CCTV camera will be recorded by the AFRS only to confirm that you are not a criminal, right? So only to confirm that you are not sitting in some database or that you're not on a wanted person's list. Et cetera, et cetera. So the issue here is that it's really unpredictable. You know, the data that is collected, also the data that is being matched, that it is being matched with, are both unpredictable. It's primarily an infringement of fundamental rights. And of course, accuracy is a huge problem. So accuracy is a problem because you may be wrongly identified. We know that facial recognition systems work better for some people and not as well for others, usually those who have been historically disadvantaged or structurally disadvantaged. So of course accuracy is a problem, but I think when we only focus on accuracy when it comes to identification systems, when it comes to 1:N matching, what we risk doing is we end up saying we need to optimize for a problematic system. So if a system creates an infringement of fundamental rights in the first place, do we really need to make it an accurate system is a question that I think, you know, regulators and civil society around the world is grappling with. But I think it's really important to stress that, especially when it comes to the difference between verification and identification. So Anushka briefly mentioned the case of the missing children in New Delhi, and I want to talk a little bit about how that story evolved over the last 2 or 3 years, actually. So you know, it's globally recognized as one of those really difficult cases to critique. I have been asked this multiple times at multiple meetings. You know, there's this amazing use case where the Delhi police use facial recognition and reunited 3,000 children with their families. So how can we say that we should ban technologies like facial recognition? So if we step back a little bit and say, you know, what is the rationale for using this, for using facial recognition in general, but also in this particular case? And there's a very strong narrative of safety and security and using AI for good. I mean, AI for good is actually a catchphrase in the field. As of now, you know, you have huge organizations such as the International Telecommunications Union that spend a lot of money every year just finding good uses for AI. And so, you know, it's at first glance, it's extremely difficult to say, well, you shouldn't use this technology. But when we look closer into what this technology has actually done, we find that the accuracy rate, firstly, is less than 1%. The system couldn't distinguish between boys and girls. But most importantly, like I said, with identification, accuracy is important, but it's not the fundamental question. The question here is, what do you mean by the word found, right? Because whenever we use a technology that has some sort of nexus with fundamental rights, the question always boils down to, does the use of this technology justify any possible infringement? And so in this case, the answer would lie in understanding whether it was actually successful in doing what it said it did. What we found was that we don't actually know whether the 3,000 as a number indicates 3,000 people or 3,000 children who could be matches. We don't know what the threshold was. We don't know whether these were just mere correlations that were never actually confirmed. And so it's difficult to talk about the success even of 3,000 children being less than 1%, because 3,000 at the end of the day is a substantial number. But did it actually happen is something that we're still trying to find out through RTIs and through, you know, more engagement with the government. So I didn't mean to zoom in. Okay, so the mission creep that we're talking about actually started in January of 2019. So the RTI that IFF sent talks about this particular case in 2019. But actually, this started a whole year before in a case called Mohammad Sabir versus the state of New Delhi, where, you know, NGOs such as Bachpan Bachao Andolan and others went to the Delhi High Court and said, you know, the state of missing children in Delhi is really abysmal. We need to do something about this. And the court said, why not look at technology? Let's use the system on a pilot basis for 2 weeks. Just for 2 weeks, use facial recognition to see if it helps. Fast forward a year, it's still being used. I think at this point, it was 2% accuracy as the reported number by the Delhi police in court. I also want to point out that the only reason that we know these numbers is because it was reported in newspapers and by reporters who happen to be sitting in court on the day. There is no official communication as to accuracy rates as of now. Then you fast forward a year, 2019, in January, you have Sadan Haldar, and the court says, you know, you really need to get your act together, like start using technology in a way that actually helps. So please use this for one specific use case that is missing children. Fast forward to December 2019, as has been noted earlier, you know, facial recognition was used by the Delhi police, I think it was December 22nd, to identify quote-unquote rowdy elements and habitual protesters. Now, I want to pause a little bit on this here, because what's really interesting is that we started in 2018 with NGOs asking for more efficient solutions to a law enforcement problem. And 2 years later, so this is Jan 2018, in December 2019, what we see facial recognition doing is not just being used for a application that it has no real authority to do, and, you know, has no real legal basis to be used for. It's also creating new classes of people. So one of the biggest issues with facial recognition is that it doesn't work as well for women as it does for men. It doesn't work as well for dark-skinned people as it does for light-skinned people. But what about the the instance where facial recognition is being used to cull out new classifications of people. So habitual protesters actually is not a term that has any meaning in law. A protest is a right that is constitutionally protected. There's nothing wrong with being a habitual protester. But somehow the technology is being used to classify people in this bucket. I also don't know what rowdy elements means from a legal point of view. So there's no way of testing that. And then, fast forward 2 months, Amit Shah in Feb 2020, publicly said that 1,100 people were identified in riots, quote-unquote riots, in New Delhi. So this mission creep is, of course, extremely worrying for many reasons, not just because there have been, you know, it's literally like a slippery slope where you start off with a two-week trial and you end up with something, 2 years later that has no legal basis and shows no signs of stopping. So in the COVID context, it's, increasingly worrying because the Telangana police, the DGP of police tweeted that facial recognition and machine learning is going to be used for face mask violations and to enforce it. Recently, a Bangalore-based company called Cocos Labs Innovative Solutions was chosen to sort of develop cost-effective, again, low-cost solutions that would use facial recognition and thermal scanners that would work on people's faces with or without masks. Now, again, we only have the brief of what this company is meant to do and the ideas behind this company through newspaper articles. There is no official communication. There are no tenders that we can look at, so we don't really know what specifications there are. It's also, I think, useful to look at what other countries are doing at the moment, because it's always a sign of maybe what is to come. Please remember that facial recognition was at a nascent stage in China in 2014 and 2015, and it's at its stage now in India and the rest of the world. So it, I think it's almost like a foreboding in a way. So in Russia, facial recognition is used to enforce self-quarantine. I actually saw the word harassed in an official document that says you are meant to harass people who don't fully comply with self-quarantine. Police in China use this to reprimand people who don't wear masks. They also have facial recognition enabled helmets. And of course, the question is, you know, let's go back to the accuracy question, which is, does this even work? And the answer to that is, of course, overwhelming research tells us that facial recognition systems are clunky at best when it comes to real-world solutions. But also, is it, you know, given that it doesn't fully work, the bigger and much more important question is this a constitutionally recognized violation of our privacy? And I think the mission creep is particularly important to note because we face very specific structural difficulties as researchers and as advocates and as civil society who work on these systems. So if I can call your attention to this third column of deployment. So most of our work as of now, whether it's IFF, whether it's me, whether it's other independent researchers like Smriti, whether it's academics, all of us are more or less living in this realm. So we come to know of a facial recognition system because we see a newspaper article or we file an RTI asking, you know, are there any projects that we should know of? The likelihood of us unearthing a new project through RTI is very, very slim. So by and large, it's through newspaper articles that we are told something has been deployed, right? And at that point, we ask, okay, so, you know, does it work? Where does the data come from? What happens to the data? Is this verification of identification? Who can use it? And things like that. Of course, these are really, really important questions to ask. But if we look at how facial recognition systems are actually built, it's easy to see that actually we come into the life cycle of a system far too late. And this is because of a structural issue, right? So civil society, advocates, lawyers, are invited very late at the table if they're invited at all. In 2018, we had a bunch of AI policy documents that talked about use cases that we should be prioritizing. and, you know, funding and things like that for facial recognition, not a single civil society person was invited into the room. So when we have an AI strategy doc, the first time that civil society even sees it is after it has been written, right? So, and of course, RTIs have huge exceptions for law enforcement, for national security. So another thing that happens is that even if we do ask really difficult questions at the stage of deployment, the likelihood of us actually getting meaningful answers is low. Of course, IFF has done fantastic work to unearth a lot of stuff, but I think the scope for what we need to do is much, much bigger. So what would it look like if we were allowed to come two steps back, right? If we were, if the design, the development, and the deployment of facial recognition was made a deliberative process, it was made a democratic process, it was made a meaningful process. So then what kinds of questions we could ask is, do you actually need the system, right? What do you need to use the system for? Is that a legitimate use? What does your data set look like? How have you decided to put together this data set? How will you train your algorithm? What will you tell your algorithm to look for? You know, are you going to do verification or identification? That's just at the design stage. And that's at a stage where you're just conceptualizing what this would look like. So it could be either in a government office where we're saying, okay, this is what we want to use facial recognition for. Just imagine in a parallel world where we happened to be at the Home Ministry when they were conceptualizing the AFRS, right? So we could ask all of these questions and sort of make sure that we hit the ground running when it comes to forward-looking policy and also deployment. And then we could look at development to say, okay, so fine, now we think that this use case is going to go forward. How do you define success for your algorithm? So if there's a 10% match, will you book someone under the AFRS? You know, will you even deploy the AFRS if your accuracy rate, or would you deploy the, you know, the system for catching missing, for finding missing children in Delhi if the accuracy rate was less than 1%? Can it tell between boys and girls? What kind of errors are you seeing? How do you test the algorithm? Right. So we could put in place accountability mechanisms. We could sort of peer into the system itself, and also peer into the institutions and the individuals that make these systems deployed in the public realm. So the structural issue, I realized there was a lot of information about like a machine learning system, but please feel free to like leave questions either in the chat or at the question and answer session at the end. But essentially, as of now, we are only allowed to live here. And so when we think of mission creep, all of this, the design and the development is happening as a precursor to mission creep, but we aren't invited into that process. And so as a structural issue, we have to keep in mind that we're only seeing the tip of the iceberg. And so when we think about mission creep, and when we think about you know, use cases that we see in newspapers and things like that, there we have to reckon with the fact that we're being invited to the table extremely, extremely late. And it's particularly important to consider all of this when you consider that it's actually companies who are carrying out functions of the state. So in the case of the Delhi police, actually in the case of the Delhi police using facial recognition to monitor CA protesters, it isn't the Home Ministry that developed a system. It isn't the Home Ministry that decided what that system would look like. It's a company called Inefu Labs somewhere in Gurgaon that decided what happens. But it's carrying out essentially the function of the state, because only the people who develop that technology and run that technology understand how it works and why it works. So I think it's, when we think about privately developed public technology, the constitutional rights aspect of it and the state regulation aspect of it becomes, it kind of like flips on its own head, because we cannot regulate Inefu Labs, which is privately developing technology. So what does that mean when you have an opaque system where we're only invited in at the very last minute? Related to my previous point, you know, most of these systems, I think the opacity and the complexity of systems is often overplayed to say that, you know, there's no way of knowing how a system made a particular decision, and we will never know whether it was fair or not. And all of those things, I think, are true, but only to an extent. There is a way of making transparent, accountable, scrutable, explainable systems, but that is not happening now, because the conversation is not even something that is being invited at this point by stakeholders who control what is being deployed. I've already touched upon the third point before, where there's systemic exclusion of stakeholders, particularly civil society, which means that the mechanisms that we have are limited at best. I already spoke about INEFU Labs as well. But in this case, I want to focus a little bit on audits. So audits of algorithmic systems in general is a really fashionable topic at the moment, with governments and with companies and even civil society and academics calling for audits. But I think it's really important to stay critical of audits as designed by companies who build these systems, because there's a clear misalignment of incentives. You know, I think audits give us the ability to come into the process a little earlier, but even then it's limited at best if it's the company that decides what an auditing mechanism looks like. And I spoke about this in terms of the CAA, where not only are facial recognition systems discriminatory, but they're used to create new ways of discrimination and new classifications that could be the basis of discrimination. So I'd invite you to sort of think about the various textures of accountability mechanisms that we need and the kind of questions that we should be asking. With that, I will end my presentation and hand it over to Smriti.
Thanks so much, Vidushi, for that. Smriti, you also now have presenter access, so you can go ahead and begin whenever you figure it out.
Thanks. Just give me a sec. I'll get this started. Sorry, I'm having some trouble with this. It won't show me the upload sign when I click on the screen share.
Hold on, let me check. On your bottom left, you will see an icon, and once you click on that, you should be able to.
Yeah, it says permission wasn't granted. Error, permission to access not granted. Is there any way you could run the slide at your end for me?
Yeah, I can do that. Not a problem.
Thanks. Thanks so much. Okay. Just in the interest of time.
Yeah, absolutely. Let me know when you'd like me to change the slides, and I will
thanks so much.
Go ahead with that.
Okay, while that comes up, I think let's just get started. Hi, everyone. Good evening. So what I'm going to do is just take off from where, Arushi and Vidushi left off and start tracing what are some of the global regulatory responses around regulation of facial recognition. And as you would have noted, you know, from the previous speakers, that this is clearly an unsolved problem. So no one in the world has managed to reach a right response. But there are clearly countries who've thought a little bit more and are more advanced in their thinking. And that's what I'm going to trace over the next few minutes. Sorry, Shivani, but I cannot see the presentation.
Yeah, I'm just
okay, cool. Fine.
Okay.
So, you know, while that comes up, I think another thing to note is that the solutions that I'll be discussing, you'll see that there are a lot of variations in what is being proposed around, you know, whether we are talking about government use or private use, and people are talking about distinct approaches for those two uses. Similarly, about the kind of use case that is involved, whether we are talking about verification or we are talking about identification, and people feel that, you know, maybe you need differential kind of approaches in terms of regulation, even in based on the use case. And for the rest, I'll have to just wait a sec for the slide.
Can you see it now, Doshi? No?
Nope, sorry.
Okay, I think, let me just figure that out. Until then,
okay, until then, what I'm going to do is I'll just keep speaking. I'll try to explain what was on the screen so that like people get a sense and we can pick up on the slides, you know, whenever they're up. So on the first slide, what I had was basically a world map, which has been compiled by Surfshark, where they have mapped out what are the deployments all across the world. And once the slides come up, you're going to see where basically they've shown in green, you know, what are the countries across the world which have deployed some other form of facial recognition in the public sector. And the whole map is basically green, which is indicative that every country is using it to some or the other extent. And the only exception are a few countries in Africa where they didn't have data about whether or not it's being used. But for the rest, everyone is using it from, you know, kind of purposes we've been hearing about, the investigation and law enforcement uses, but also at border controls, for entry into airports, for databases like driving license databases and mapping whether you're already on the system. So there are all of these multiple uses that are, you know, already happening. And while China is, of course, you know, the most egregious adopter and the most widespread adopter, what we do see is that this is happening across all kinds of economic and political regimes. So from everyone from authoritarian regimes to liberal democracies has been adopting facial recognition technologies. And I'm going to focus in this discussion more on the developments in the United States and in the European region.
Sorry, Smriti, what I can do is I can share my screen. I think there's something wrong with the presentation. So I can share my screen and that way everyone will be able to view it.
Perfect. Would that be,
yeah.
That'll be great.
I think you should be able to see my screen now, folks.
Great. So can we just go to the third slide, please?
Yes, absolutely.
Yeah, so this was the map that I just described, and we'll go next to a map of United States, which is basically data which has been compiled, you know, to show that what are the different use cases in the country, but also what are the emerging regulatory responses. And US really presents a very interesting example because, you know, they are on one hand trying to compete with China on AI research in general and facial recognition research. So whether you look at research funding or the number of patents or business models, they are really, you know, it's US and China who are directly seen as competitors in this space. But unlike China, US, of course, has a much stronger, you know, history of civil liberties enforcement. They have independent courts. They have a stronger civil society with a stronger voice. So really the kind of debates that we are seeing in the US are very interesting because there's a lot of activity happening because of this tension between, on the one hand, the business interest and on the other hand, the pushback from the civil society. Next slide, please. Right. So what I'm going to just describe briefly is that, you know, even though I was saying US has a lot of developments that's happening, there is, of course, no, you know, central or federal law that they have come up with to regulate this. But what they have instead are pockets of regulation that are happening across different levels. So, you know, at the level of the cities itself, many of us who are following the space would have heard about the ban on facial recognition in San Francisco. So similar to that, there are 8 cities which have independently at their, you know, municipal or administrative level in the states of California and Massachusetts come out with bans on government use of facial recognition. And this is interesting because even though San Francisco is this very oft-quoted example, once we go deeper down into the text of what, you know, is permitted and restricted there, they actually do have some exceptions there also. So they have exceptions where they say if the sheriff or the district attorney is using facial recognition for investigation purposes or for, you know, a prosecution, there are, you know, exceptions for that if they can show that it's necessary. So even places which are banning are bound either because of their federal structure or because of, you know, the pushback from the industry for some kind of exceptions in these laws. The other law we've seen at a statewide level is in the state of California and a few others, where they have imposed restrictions on body-worn cameras. So body-worn cameras is not, you know, as common here in India, but it's very common by now in the United States. And these are cameras which are basically on the police officer's clothes or on their body. They wear this camera, and the idea of it was to enhance accountability and transparency in their dealings with people, you know, with the public, so there's no harassment by the police. But as you know, something like facial recognition started getting incorporated in that, what was meant for the protection of people turned out to be something which is monitoring them all the time at all different angles, you know. And clearly all the kind of things we've been talking about in terms of discrimination and intrusion, those concerns really got highlighted. So what the state of California did was that they've imposed a ban for 3 years on using facial recognition in these body-worn cameras. So both of these, you know, the city level and the California bans are examples where you've said do not use facial recognition. But we've also seen a more recent example emerge from the state of Washington, where they've said you can use facial recognition for state and local purposes, but you need to regulate it. So this is a very different approach. And it actually tries to address, you know, a lot of the points that we heard as the drawbacks of the current system. So it talks about something like before you can adopt any facial recognition system as a state agency, you need to find and file an accountability report, which will, you know, trace all the transparency about what are you trying to achieve, what data are you using, which vendor are you going for, why did you choose a particular vendor? The next thing that they say is about independent testing. And there again, it's an you know, an interesting provision that they introduce, where they basically say that the vendor that you adopt has to give open API access to people who want to test its systems. And that's one of the preconditions, so that there can be independent audit by third parties such as researchers. And only then can you, you know, choose to go with that vendor. What they've also done is tried to create a task force where they've said that, you know, this is a task force consisting of vendors and law enforcement, but the majority of the people are independent actors who are civil society agents, who are people representing consumer groups, people representing disadvantaged groups, and all of them will sit together to look at the kind of deployments that are taking place and give recommendations on, you know, is this an acceptable use? Is there a scope for discrimination? So these are some of the kind of accountability and, you know, enforcement measures that they've tried to bring in. And the backstory to this is supposed to be that Microsoft, you know, is the company which has been pushing for some sort of regulation instead of ban on facial recognition, and is known to be the company which was behind this bill and now the law which came about in Washington. So in a way, this is reflects this tussle between the civil society and the corporate interests, where the civil society is pushing more aggressively for banning or moratoriums, whereas you know, business interests are pushing for regulation and allowing, subject to XYZ checks and balances. Next slide, please. So the previous slide was about like what's happening in terms of government use, and that's the place where most of the discussions have taken place so far. But there's also more recently discussion about what about regulation of private development and private use. And here again, you know, the approach that the United States has adopted is very much in the context of their fear of over-regulation and how that will impact their businesses vis-a-vis the developments in China, which are taking place without any regulation. So this is a draft executive order which the White House released earlier this year, where, you know, they try to set out these 10 principles which they say should guide any federal agency which decides to regulate AI more broadly. So this is not specifically about facial recognition. It's on AI regulation. And they make some points which are pretty useful and some points which, you know, you can understand where they're coming from in the context that I just explained. So one thing they talk about is this need for public engagement and public consultations before making any kind of regulatory decisions. They talk about the need for a cost-benefit analysis. So you need to weigh all the costs and the benefits and then proceed, you know, on what is the appropriate course of regulation. But of course, one of the challenges in this kind of a framework is that a lot of the cost that we are talking about, right? Cost to privacy, trust to discrimination, unfair treatment, these are not always quantifiable costs. So, and in a typical cost benefit analysis, the instructions are to the extent possible, you should quantify them. So while the, you know, the cost of what the regulation will come to the companies in terms of, you know, opening access or doing some kind of reporting, that's more easy to quantify. It becomes difficult when you start pitting, you know, unmeasurable things against measurable things, and we need to see how that will pan out in actual enforcement. The other thing they suggest, and this is very limited to the, you know, the business interest argument that I was talking about, they say you need to limit regulatory overreach, right? So if you find that the cost of something exceeds the benefit, you should choose not to regulate that, because eventually you need to keep the American business interests in mind. And they say at that point, you should think about some kind of non-regulatory approaches, which could be voluntary codes of conduct, or it could be, you know, pilot projects and experimental projects, things like sandboxes. So, you know, that's the kind of approach they're saying you should think about as a backup and not always think about regulation. Then they say you should look at trustworthy tech. So these are the values they highlight: privacy, fairness, non-discrimination, and any kind of cost-benefit analysis should take into account whether, you know, trust is being created in the system on account of all of these factors. And finally, they talk about interagency coordination, which is basically that so many agencies have now started to regulate this. How do you have a consistent view, you know, without having a national law? How do you make sure all the different authorities which are coming up with this, you know, somehow speak to each other before they come up with what the solution is? And these are all points which are equally relevant, even in a context like, you know, India, where so many authorities, as Anushka was explaining, are coming up with their own, facial recognition system. So are these systems speaking to each other, or, you know, talking about best practices in any way? Next slide, please. So with that, I'm going to jump to the developments in Europe. And one of the interesting things that I wanted to point out here is that, you know, so the European Commission has been in the process of developing a white paper on artificial intelligence. And there was a leaked version of this paper which came out in December last year. And they had in that document suggested that there should be a 3 to 5 year ban on use of facial recognition in public spaces, both by the public sector as well as the private sector. And this was very much coming from the idea that, you know, everything we've talked about so far, the concerns that were highlighted by civil society. But when the document came out, they had rolled back on that, and it didn't contain this sort of a, you know, moratorium requirement. What they said instead is that basically they identify biometric identification in public spaces as a high risk area. And it's interesting here that they are distinguishing what Vidushi was explaining, identification from authentication. So they're talking about 1-to-many kind of checks. By identification, they mean that. And they're distinguishing private spaces and public spaces. So they're saying only when it's a 1-to-many check in a public space, and that's happening in an automated manner, that's something which is, you know, more risky and has more implications for rights. And that's something which should be regulated. And they say we'll start a separate process to think about what that regulation would be. Next, please. So now I'll just end with 2 case studies, you know, which have come up in Europe, and how they tell us about, you know, what is the kind of thinking that's going on amongst data protection authority and courts in those jurisdictions. So there are 2 cases which happened in Sweden and France independently. Both countries saw local authorities which were trying to adopt and test facial recognition in schools. So in Sweden, they started this pilot program where they went to this one school, and over a 3-week period, they took the, you know, facial scans of about 20-25 children, and they were trying to use this for monitoring attendance in public schools. In France, there was a similar case where in the southern France region, there were 2 schools where the municipality said that we want to use facial recognition for controlling access to school. So at the school gate, we want to make sure that, you know, there is no identity theft, there are no intrusions, there's a safety requirement, and therefore only people who are vetted through the system and authenticated will come into the school. And both authorities in these countries basically rejected, you know, this kind of a use under the provisions of the GDPR, where sensitive data like biometric data requires certain enhanced protection. And 2 interesting points that they make is that, you know, you can't in such systems say that I've taken the consent of the student or I've taken the consent of the parent. This is not a valid ground because of the inherent power differential between the school as an authority and these people who want to go and study in that school. So consent is not a legitimate ground for this. And then they say that there are obviously less intrusive alternatives, right? You could have an entry badge in a school which is allowed to, you know, allows you to enter into the school, or you could have attendance rolls, which is the traditional means of doing these purposes. So in the name of convenience or in the name of efficiency, you can't take steps which have such disproportionate impact on privacy. Next, please. And the next one, we have basically a decision which came up in the United Kingdom, which I think is one of the first court decisions on use of facial recognition by law enforcement agencies. And this was in the context of a live facial recognition system, which is being tested in the UK by the South Wales Police. And a live system is basically one where in the CCTV feature itself, while the video is being recorded in the CCTV, the facial recognition feature is integrated in that. So it's not that you take the footage and later run it through a system. It's happening in real time, and you're looking at people in a crowd and you're matching their faces against an existing list of, you know, wanted or blacklisted people, they call them by all of these names, but you're trying to match it with a pre-existing list. And this was challenged by a individual who was, you know, twice on this system. And the way the system worked was that, you know, the live recording would take place. But if you're not found to be a match, then immediately your biometrics would be deleted from the database. But the regular CCTV video would be kept for a 30-day period. So the court looked at, the High Court in UK looked at, you know, the arguments that the petitioner had made around data protection, human rights, equality, the questions around discrimination. And they unfortunately held that, you know, this is something which is in line with the laws in UK, and it's within the limit of the permissible exceptions, and therefore they allowed the system to proceed. But this is since then appeal has been filed, and I thought I'll highlight three points which I thought are particularly relevant. While the, you know, decision of course is problematic on its own, but there are three points which make it even more problematic if we try to translate this in the Indian context, right? So the first they talk about is that there are sufficient safeguards in the primary law. By this they mean the, you know, the Data Protection Act, as well as the, you know, other laws on equality and human rights, as well as existing standard operating procedures. But as you've heard throughout this presentation, that's something which is completely missing in our context, right? We don't have a data protection law yet. The draft that we have has pretty sweeping exceptions being proposed for law enforcement purposes. So even with that law, we are going to be most likely in a position where a lot of this is not sufficiently protected. The second thing they say is that the deployment was not covert. So there was very clear indication to everyone in the crowd, whether it was being used in a stadium or in a concert, that this is being used with live facial recognition. Whereas a lot of the uses which we, you know, as Vidushi was talking about, we come to know about it when it's reported in the press that, you know, on a group of protesters, certain technology was used. There is no advance notice of these kind of uses. And finally, they had done impact assessments, which of course people have said were not sufficient and not sufficiently robust. But the fact is that there were impact assessments which had been done, and there was independent academic analysis in this case by the University of Cardiff which had been done, which is of course again not the case in any kind of deployments that we are seeing here in the Indian context, which makes any of this happening here much more scary. So last slide, please. So just to wind up and, you know, to connect back to the topic that we have before us, that all of this that we've discussed becomes all the more relevant, important, and brings into sharp focus the questions around facial recognition come into sharp focus in light of the new cases, use cases we are seeing in the COVID-19 context. So, you know, whether it's this transition from where all the offices and buildings were using fingerprints, will now start thinking, and this is already happening, moving towards contactless biometrics like facial recognition, the integration of thermal scanning features into some of the camera features, the use of facial recognition for quarantine restrictions, the use of AI for mask detection. Like, this may detect the person's identity, or it may only be an object detection, which I believe Uber is now using to detect before a driver takes on any ride, to detect whether, you know, they are wearing a mask. So these kind of uses will come up more and more, and you know, with that, questions around how do you balance privacy and, now in this case, public interest in the form of health and safety and life. So thank you.
Thanks so much. Thanks so much, Kriti. I think go on, Srinivas.
I can open up for questions. Maybe most of you have joined in the guest mode. you type in your questions in the public chat and we can pick them up. Or you can also just let us know in the chat that you have a question and maybe we can unmute you if you're locked.
I think there's a question in the
chat. Rohan has asked, is anything currently being done to improve government transparency? Anushka, would you like to take that?
Yeah. So with regard to government transparency, it's really hard for one individual or one organization to actually do a lot, but the way that you can hold the government accountable is by asking them questions and responding to the answers that they're saying with other actions. So like the RTIs that IFF files, we use that as a basis for policy interventions and for strategic litigation. So that is one of the ways that you can improve, not really improve, but hold them accountable through the already existing mechanisms in place, which is the RTI Act. Thank you.
Thanks, Anushka. There's also
a question.
Go on, please.
Yeah, thank you. I also want to say that I think that the role of the courts cannot be overemphasized here, or rather taking the legal route, because a lot of legal efforts are being made to sort of talk about government transparency, government procurement of technology, particularly post-Puttaswamy in 2017. And when we think about government transparency, I would encourage us to think about, like, in addition to everything that Anushka said, to also think about how we can hold the systems to a standard of transparency that then would necessitate the government to be transparent as well. I think that's a link that we often forget. Thanks.
Thanks so much, Vidushi. We have another question for Harsh. So for Smriti, Harsh asks, do you see a change in consent model used in schools in case such technologies are being used in Delhi schools? If yes, should parents always be considered for consent or someone else?
Right. So, as far as I know, the facial recognition part of it has not been tested or talked about in the context of Delhi schools, although there is wide deployment of CCTVs, which is taking place. But there are other regions from Gujarat and, Tamil Nadu, there are some reports about people wanting to use facial recognition in schools. But I think my point more broadly would be, although we know, from the draft personal data protection bill that it is trying to give some enhanced protections for children's rights, but it's also saying that, parents will be the one who will be the one responsible for giving consent. But I would say that this is not a question which should arise at all, because, whether it's by children or by parents. So firstly, there is that question of autonomy and the rights of child and whether parents should be the one taking this call. But secondly, the point that I talked about, in the European context, this imbalance between the school and the parents and children, like the question of consent. So this is not a use case which should be considered at all, whether with or without consent, because consent in this context is pretty much meaningless.
Right. Vidushi, Anushka, would you like to add to that?
Not at the moment, thank you. I think Smriti answered.
Okay. Right. Vidushi, there's another one for you. A lot of companies are shifting from fingerprint biometrics to facial recognition, citing COVID as a reason, as in it can spread, the spread can be via contact. How can we deal with something like this?
Yeah, I think the problem with, emergency related mandating of technology, like we're seeing now, is that safety and security is treated like the obvious thing that would trump all of our fundamental rights that we understand them to be. When you have a company that says you can't work for us unless you do this, I think it's very difficult to push back on it. I know that people have been facing this even in context of like contact tracing and download Arogya Setu and things like that. I think the one thing to definitely stress on is the, like, if you go back to what I said about authentication, to the bit about accuracy, to the bit about, you know, how do you know what you're going to do with this data? The data protection regulation, when it does come into being, would make a lot of your practices illegal. Things like that, I think, could help. I think the unfortunate, we need to like push back on the assumption that technology is the answer to a problem like COVID instead of trying to optimize for the technology. I hope that answers your question.
I have a small announcement to make. So we have some readings that's been shared, the shared notes section of the page. Below public chat, you have something called shared notes. And once you click that, you have some paper articles, which you can through after this. Okay. There was one more question, I guess, specifically Telangana. Anushka, do you want to answer that? It's about, is there any available government facial recognition in urban local government elections and having people from election? Am I breaking?
No, please go ahead.
Sorry. Okay. Having people from election commission as well as parties who can cross check the voters, what is the major need for government to adopt facial recognition?
There are no videos that I came across while researching for this, but the Telangana government did this by releasing a circular, which we took as an authentic source because the government itself has released it. This is a very legitimate question, that why was facial recognition used when the parties and the election commission themselves can cross-check voters. The reason that the election commission gave was they wanted to ensure that voter fraud does not happen, but we were not convinced with this argument. I have pasted the link to our post in the public chat. So if anybody wants to know more about that particular project, they can go to the link and read about it. Thank you.
If any of you would also like to unmute yourself and ask questions directly for the speakers, you can also do that.
Shivani, there's a question about discrimination towards racial minorities. Would it be a good time to answer that?
Please go on.
Yeah, I want to make sure we didn't miss any. So in terms of discrimination towards minorities in general, I think there's been a lot of work, what some people like Frank Pasquale call the first wave of algorithmic accountability, where we started seeing that, you know, there was this certain discrimination against groups. So Joy Bulamani's work on facial recognition systems from IBM, Microsoft, and things like that showed that these systems had very, very high accuracy rates for white men, but very low accuracy rates for black women and things like that. So one of the, you know, the easiest things that we can do is just diversify your training data. So just have a more representative view of what people look like. There were, in the last, maybe since 2014 and 2015, we haven't seen big fiascos like this, but in 2014, African American woman was confused for a gorilla by Google facial recognition. There was also a facial recognition system that was made to hold a beauty contest, and only blonde and blue-eyed women won that contest. The discrimination is baked in the process of design, of development, and also in deployment. So I think the first thing to do would be to democratize and diversify how we think about that. But also, I think the second thing is to ask about think more about the premise on which some systems are used. So for instance, if you look at credit scoring algorithms that are used you know, this is not a facial recognition specific thing, but I think it's helpful to give you this example. So credit scoring will work for people who have been historically, you know, well off and have, you know, rich people on their contacts list and things like that. So that is by definition discriminatory because it is meant to fail people who haven't been in the formal credit system before. So I think just thinking about like the societal and institutional reality within which these systems actually are meant to work can also, you know, correct some of the discrimination that we see.
Thanks so much, Vidushi. Smriti and Anushka, do you have anything to add to that?
Not on that. There is one about MyGate. So if, unless Anushka has something, maybe I could take that.
Yes, please go ahead.
Okay, so there's a question about apps like MyGate, which are forcing people to take IDs and scan. And I just wanted to highlight in this, you know, the discussion to go back to Puttaswamy, because the, you know, the most of what we have right now and what we argue in terms of need for privacy and proportionality is coming from that as the legal base. But that applies to users by the state. So, you know, infringement of privacy by the state. And it becomes more tricky because when you talk about private actors and body corporates like MyGate, because we have very limited protections under the existing, you know, Information Technology Act, which has some provisions. So MyGate can be, you know, hauled up for not keeping your data in a safe and secure manner because it's bound by certain requirements under that. But for the rest, if someone's RWA or their apartment is making this compulsory, there really isn't recourse under the Puttaswamy framework to, you know, challenge this.
Thanks so much, Smriti. There's one question that I think all three of you could probably address. Someone's asked, how can you balance privacy and rights over social irresponsibility like riots and criminality? And I think any of you can take that. So please go ahead.
I can start. Unless Anushka, do you want to go?
No, please.
Okay, so I mean, I think the first thing to emphasize here is that I don't think it's anyone's case that like privacy is a you know, an absolute right that doesn't have restrictions. Privacy does have restrictions that are, you know, written in the law that are well understood. Puttaswamy laid down that any restrictions to the right to privacy must be maintained by law, I mean, sorry, provided in the law, be necessary and proportionate and towards a legitimate aim. So I think the balancing mechanisms are very much in the law as it exists now. Recently, this is not specifically to do with questionable criminality. Recently, the bombing like, came out with a judgment that said, you know, while the government is well within their rights to check things like criminality and things like that, you cannot risk rights of individuals by giving wide reasons such as public good and public safety and things like that. So if you have to violate someone's right to privacy, you have to demonstrate that you pass the four-part test. And I think that's something that, you know, is well understood in the realm of law, but is only well understood in the realm of see playing similarly in executive or in law enforcement or otherwise.
I think what I agree with what Vidushi said also, as she has mentioned previously, it's not necessary that facial recognition will solve the problems that it purports to solve. It's not necessary that it will reduce riots and criminality. Also, if we're not balancing privacy and rights over social irresponsibility, the point that we're trying to make here is this system is being used in a lack of legal framework. So while this system is being deployed, they should firstly have a consultation wherein they decide the criteria on which this system will be used. They set up a legal framework which will regulate this system so that misuse does not happen. We're not saying that FRT should not be used. There is no situation in which FRT can be used. What we're saying is there needs to be a situation wherein the misuse is contained as much as possible.
thanks so much, you guys. I will take one last question because we're almost out of time. And let me just pick one. Okay. Someone has asked, with AI FRS understanding confined to a narrow set of people, how do you think the general public can be educated to ask the right questions when FRS facial recognition systems become a norm? If any of you would like to take that, Smriti, maybe.
Really, advocacy is not my forte. So I really, you know, my work is mostly about research, and transmitting that to people is obviously always a challenge. So I'm not really best placed to answer that.
I can try. And Anushka, I don't mean to volunteer you, Anushka. So I think, you know, if I were to say that giving every government official 10 rupees every time you see them is becoming a norm, I think that we will push back on it, right? Because as a society, we understand that money is something that we value, that it is personal to us, that people just can't ask us for our money and keep our money in, you know, different cupboards in their house, because it's fundamentally against the norm of what we consider normal, right? So I think that we need to ourselves and our data, how we think about money. And that's a very, very tall order. But I think when we think about, you know, how data is used against us, how data is used for us, who data is used by, what people can learn about us, like, you know, if you give me 10 data points, not me, but like if you feed in 10 data points about yourself to a machine learning system, the inferences can be really, really, really invasive. And I think the fact that we don't comprehend that as a society is why we don't ask the right questions. So when facial recognition becomes the norm, it's going to be a situation where, you know, there is a password to a lot of you, like, so where do you go, who do you hang out with, who do you make, and all of these things. The password to knowing all of that can someday become your face. And I think the minute we come to that realization is when we will start asking the right questions naturally.
Right. Thank you so much, Vidushi. We're out of time. It is 7:30 and we really don't really want to go beyond it. I know that there are some questions that we did not get to address, but you can also reach out to our panelists separately and ask them your questions. I think a lot of them have also been answered in the chat box itself. I would like to thank firstly Anushka, Smriti, and Vidushi, all three of you, for coming here and talking to us. It's something that requires more open conversation in an accessible manner, and IFF will try to host more of these as often as possible. Thank you so much for joining us today. If you like the work that we're doing, we work on India's digital rights and ensuring that we combat mass surveillance and net shutdowns through institutional engagement with parliament, the courts, and if you do like our work, please do consider donating to us. You can go to our website at innetfreedom.in and look at our work, and hopefully we'll see you soon for another one of these webinars. Thank you for joining us. I will now also stop recording the session.